So I have this, I have a senior person in my life. I want to clarify that it's not my mother, okay?
Oh.
But it is a senior person who's in my life. And I may have, you know, I have the Alzheimer's myself, so I may have told a version of the story on the pod before, but this was a fresh one that happened this week. So this senior, who I love dearly, doesn't know how to use emojis properly. Uh-huh. And so the big mistake they make is that when they write me to deliver sad news, they use the smiley face with the tears because they have mistaken that for a crying face. And so I got one last week that's like, I'm going to make up the names, okay, just to change it. But I got one last week that's like, you're not going to believe this. Uncle John has cancer. Smiley face tears.
Laughing so hard, I'm crying.
And so I don't know whether to tell this person. I got to tell this person, right?
Because yeah,
how many people are they sending this to?
That's a correction that needs to be made. There's no doubt about it.
Now, the only thing is, potentially, say they were to benefit financially from this person's app. And maybe they are that sick. They're that greedy. Like, good news.
Maybe they're saying, like, Jimmy, it's almost happening.
No, because it's happened multiple times. It's like, did you hear about Brenda? She got in a car accident. She's dead. Smiley face.
Are you sure they're not evil?
So, yeah, I guess I'm going to have to tell this beloved person about it but it does provide me, you know, entertainment when you do get a sad when you do get a sad text like that, it's good to be able to laugh at the end of it.
Well, see, at least
not
that
like real people close to me. It's not like somebody, it's, you know, they're not that close to me, the people they're talking about. So
I thought for a second you were talking about Bobby Mack.
It does seem it could fit there.
Welcome to the Rubber Boots Podcast. It's James, Lester, Puffy, and Christoph. This is our post-election edition, or is it still in the middle of the election? We're figuring maybe Thursday or Friday. Maybe you're listening to this on Saturday or Sunday, so you might have gotten your fill of election coverage by now. We're just going to be fully upfront. There are times when we tape this podcast where we try to just not talk about subjects that have happened earlier in the week because we want to seem current. We don't want to seem dated. But because the election has dominated all of our lives, we're just going to be upfront with you. It's currently 1:30 on Tuesday afternoon, Election Day in the United States of America. And because Stoff has 19 other podcasts now, he's just added about two more. He's got Gino Retta's Junior Hockey Weekly now on the mandate.
Junior Hockey Magazine, but yeah.
Sorry, Junior Hockey Magazine. So Stoff probably won't get around to Rubber Boots till later in the week. We got Rubber Beauties. So we won't do a ton of election talk because I know that you come to Rubber Boots to escape, but I think we'd be stupid if we didn't talk about it. So first of all, I just thought, we'll do a quick prediction, just your quick election prediction. And so the people listening on Saturday or Sunday or whatever, they can mock us if we're completely wrong, or they can go, wow, if we're completely right. Christoph will not be editing this. I'm not going to go Biden in a landslide. Edit point. Trump in a landslide. Edit point.
Kanye still, in a landslide.
Still to be determined. Still waiting on Pennsylvania. So we'll only do one take. I will go first. All right. I know that Trump can win. I have fears of that. But I believe, Jimmy's prediction, that it will be over early. That Biden will win Arizona or North Carolina or perhaps Florida, or perhaps more of these, and that it will be clear fairly early in the night that Joe Biden's going to win substantially over Donald Trump. Boom. That's my prediction. Puffy?
I definitely hope that Biden wins. But I saw yesterday that a $5 million wager came in on Trump to win. And usually when big money comes in on a bet, they tend to have information. And so I am fearful that this person knows something. And I am thinking Trump wins.
That's the bet that swung Trump from being, I think from Biden, from being like minus 180 to minus 165.
Yeah.
It's a pretty big deal.
The betting for this election has been bigger than any event ever. Like,
yeah,
it's
but the most of the bets have been on Biden, have they not?
Yeah, well, that's why he's
yes,
favored.
Yes, 90% or something, yeah.
So if I was to bet, I was talking to Aaron Karolnik, our betting expert, the other day, and he had said at the point, if I was to bet 100 on Biden, I would win 80 if he won.
Yes.
Is that what it's at right now? Or are you saying I only win 65?
It was at 65. I think it moved back up a bit. But yeah, you would have only won 65 after that $5 million bet went through.
But Puffy, as our resident betting expert on here, if the polls, like 538 and the majority of the polls averaged together, give Biden a 90% chance to win, and we all know that polls can be goofy, wouldn't that be a good bet to bet on Biden in general? Wouldn't it be like betting the Chiefs against the Jets with no points?
Yeah, I mean, it would be, but it's...
But the value's on Trump.
Yeah, it's a lot closer. Like, the money on the Biden bet, it's almost like they're trying to get people to bet on Biden. Because everything says that that Biden should win. But,
well, that's what I mean, though. If you had a 90% odds in a football game with no spread, you would bet on that 90% team, and you could still win, you know.
But this is an election that feels a lot more that anything can happen. And also, we don't, like... Yeah. What's going to make the bet official? Who wins it? Who remains in power? Because there's going to be a whole lot of, you know, especially if Trump loses the vote or seems to lose the vote, the whole transfer of power and all that's going to be a whole nother thing to deal with. So,
yeah.
Okay, so what was your prediction?
I'm going to say Trump.
In a close
Trump
race?
Could win. Yeah, close.
Lester?
I am going to take a page out of your good friend John Tortorella's page book. Playbook, and I'm going to sit this one out. I just can't.
I got you.
I'm sorry.
And I understand that, Lester, and that's completely that's completely understood. Stoff?
I'm voting Biden.
No, you don't have a vote.
Stoff.
All right. No, I hope Biden wins, so I'm going to put it up there, and I'm going to say he wins. All
right. So that's it. That's it for Election Central here on...
I have one hypothetical for you guys, though.
Oh! Well, why don't we roll the little Puffy's hypothetical theme?
Yo, 1, 2, 1, 2. Puffy's hypotheticals are messing with my mind. Puffy's hypotheticals, what's gonna be this time? Puffy's hypotheticals, I'm blowing.
All right, Puffy.
Okay, so say you were in line to win. You wouldn't have to put up your own money, but you were in line to claim the winnings on Trump's $5 million bet. Would you secretly cheer for Trump to win?
Sorry, so I can win how much money?
It would probably be around $13 million, I think.
Yeah.
People will, you know, that's a tough hypothetical because people won't believe our answer. But I think I speak for Lester that that's not worth the money. And we've tried to keep this pod non-political, and we will try to as much as possible. I have respect for Republicans and Democrats, and I try to not do a lot of it. I definitely stay away from Twitter, but this is different. I can't stand that man, and I could not. That would be the dirtiest money, blood money I would ever take. So, no.
I 100% agree. 100% agree.
Yeah,
I mean, no one knows. No one knows.
Don't you tempt us like that, Puffy.
In other words, Puffy's taking the money.
And just to be clear, we live in Canada. We do not live in the United States.
You know what, Puffy? I think it's like you just basically did the plot of kind of like you took the sex out of Indecent Proposal, but that's basically what it is, right? You know, I'd take the money.
That's the best part.
I'd take the money. I'd be, you know, you'd have so much money, you'd be happy, but then I couldn't look at Demi Moore the same way anymore, and I just couldn't sleep, and then it would, my whole life would fall apart. It was Demi Moore, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
Yes.
They should make that movie again, you know? They should make that movie an update with update that cast. It'd be like me. And I'm gonna say
Beyonce.
You know, I'm gonna say no. See, you gotta up the ante. You gotta make it an interracial relationship.
That's true.
Right. So me and like Scarlett Johansson.
Oh wow.
Oh yeah.
I thought you were gonna say George Clooney.
and that would really up the ante. Who gets to play the Robert Redford role?
Yeah. That's a good question. I would flip it. I would flip it, actually. I would have a female antagonist. She would say, I would give you $50 million to sleep with your husband.
Helen Mirren. Makes an appearance again on the pod. Wait a second.
Oh, my God, sorry.
A couple, then, to put all Lesters together, Helen Mirren is the Robert Redford character.
Yes.
The couple is Lester and Rod Baby.
No.
Did you remember, this is going to be an outdated sitcom reference, but when that movie Indecent Proposal was out, Mad About You was popular at the time, and it was a very good show. Helen Hunt and Paul Reiser. Paul Reiser was a good comedian in his day, and I don't remember anything about that show except Indecent Proposal was out, and they did a scene from it where they're in a casino, and they're sitting together, and this Robert Redford type guy walks up and says, "I'd give you $1 million to sleep with your wife," and they look at each other and they go, "Yeah, sure," and she just walks off. Like there's not 1 second hesitation.
We need the money.
He just keeps eating his potato chips.
Yes, actually, very quickly, we're not doing what you're watching very much these days, but that series, Mad About You, was revived. I did, I think, about 6 or 8 episodes of it. It's running on Crave, I believe, and it's well worth the watch. If you're a fan of that series, I would suggest you go back and check that out.
What you're watching?
Continue.
Brooksie and I used to watch that show early in our courtship. And does anyone say courtship anymore? I think it's an underused word.
Yeah.
Do you think on Tinder, the first message from one person to another would ever be, "Hey, I would like to start a courtship with you"?
Yeah. If you've got game, yeah.
I believe they use pre-cuffing now.
So Brooksy would watch Mad About You and pick out the continuity errors. It was ripe with continuity errors. Like there would be long scenes at the supper table where, you know, Paul Reiser would have a steak, and then the next bite he'd have a chicken, and then the chicken would be half gone, and then it would be full again. The continuity person on Mad About You is horrendous. So if you want to watch Mad About You on Crave, look for horrendous continuity problems. What else do I want to get into? Let's get to a little bit of the week that was.
Let's discuss the week that was with James Dunning and the Rubber Boots Podcast Crew.
So, bringing all Jimmy's stories together into one, Jimmy talks a lot about his golf net. He talks a lot about his dog, Hugo, who's currently sleeping next to me. And he talks a lot about going broke. So this is actually all those things together. Hugo has started, what's the proper word for it? F***ing in my golf net. It's become his favorite place to go. It's in the basement. There is like a sliding barn door. We have one of those trendy barn doors that separates this part of the basement where I keep my golf net, but I forget to close it sometimes.
Yeah.
Hugo loves the golf net, right? He when he's in a hyper mood, he runs and just launches himself at the golf net. It's crazy. And then he'll play in there with the golf balls. But now he's taken to taking dumps in the golf net or on the golf mat.
Well, it's just
marking territory. Yeah.
Yeah, we're at three right now over a span of 4 days, and Jimmy's not happy about this.
No, I wouldn't be happy.
He's the captain now.
$1,000 golf net.
Look at me, sure. Look at me, sure. I'm the captain now.
That's terrible, man. What are you going to do? Like, what are you going to do? You just have to remember to close that door?
On the positive side of Hugo, he's like his dad, making his father proud. He has an obsession with bras. He has taken to going into all the females in my house rooms and taking the bras that he finds either on the floor or in the laundry. And he's got like a stash of bras he keeps under our bed.
Wow.
So, studly guy that he is.
What's not to like?
Basically, you're raising a serial killer. He steals bras.
Yes,
that's right. Crazy. He keeps souvenirs of his victims. No, we're going to have to get him fixed probably because he's got, he literally has big balls for a little dog. And I like to not get the dogs fixed as long as possible. I want them to feel like men or women as long as they possibly can before we neuter them. But he literally, he's got a lot of testosterone going. And I think that's why he's stealing the bras and pooping on my my golf net.
Now, Jimmy, I did see on the Instagram you had a Halloween, I don't know if it was a parade in your house.
Parade. With the dogs. Just like
super that. Spreader event.
And I know you took video of it, but I hope you weren't the brains behind that operation.
Well, that leads us to another installment of Jimmy's Going Broke.
We don't know what to do, really. How much can we say? The guy on the left worked hard for the money, but he's giving it all away. He does a shop at the mall, yet his handbags and golf gear walk the wall. No, this isn't a joke. Jimmy's going broke.
My family has always loved Halloween. It's one of the favorite events in our household. And unfortunately, my kids have all grown now. Two of them are at university, Gracie's. So I don't get to take the kids out on Halloween anymore. So what we do is take the dogs out for a walk on Halloween. Now, Halloween was very muted this year, obviously. Did you guys have trick-or-treaters in your neighborhood? Did your kids go trick-or-treating? Did that happen or no?
No.
I iced my steps on purpose.
I was down in the basement with the lights out, so...
Excuse me? What were you doing?
And were you alone?
I was alone.
You were just down in the basement with your lights on.
If I'm not chilling out, I just make sure I keep the house very dark, and I get out in the basement and watch TV. When I was watching Into the Spider-Verse, if you must know.
Yeah, you got to have the lights off for that one.
Yes. Yes.
Were you thinking about Brandy?
Have her on.
So we like to just go for the last couple of years. We've just gone for a walk with the dogs. Brooksy has an assortment of dog coats. You know, I just want to say for the record, I don't like dressing up dogs. I don't think dogs, for the most part, go ahead, stop.
Do the dogs have their own bags is my question.
Handbags? Yeah, the dogs they have designer handbags. Brooksy has one of them's a pumpkin, but just like a coat to keep them warm kind of thing.
Yeah.
And we've occasionally dressed them up and just to take a couple of pictures. But this year, Brooksy, unbeknownst to me, ordered, as you saw in the Instagram video or the Twitter video, I put both places, there's outfits for dogs now where you get a cowboy on top of the dog, so the dog's like a horse. And by the way, I realized that my dogs don't gallop when they run. Somebody sent me a video of their lab who had the same outfit, and the lab was running. And the cowboy actually looks like he's in a rodeo when the dog gallops. It was unbelievable. Like, it was much better than my video because my dogs just kind of walk along sadly. But so I said, Brooksy, where'd you get those? Oh, it was like a boutique Halloween store for animals or whatever.
Oh, God.
And I'm like, oh, no.
How many lottery tickets worth? Oh no, Jimmy! They were like $60 each. What?
Good thing you only got three of them.
I'd love to look.
We spent $180 on dog costumes. there. And then you take the dogs out. Thank goodness for the social media. I don't say that often, but because we took the dogs out for a walk, you know, and there was literally not one person there to go, "Oh my dog, your dogs are so cute." Because if you're going to invest $180 in dog costumes, you want somebody to say, "Oh my dog, your dogs." So anyway, and I was trying to take, Gracie was with us, and she was trying to take video of the dogs walking with their cowboys on them, but it was too dark. Did your laptop just fall down?
Yeah, what happened is my dog farted. It smelled really bad, so I turned around to see what happened, and I knocked over my laptop. quite the event.
Yeah, wow. The whole story together.
We've never heard anything about your dog at all, Stoff.
I've talked about my dogs every episode. I didn't even know you had a dog.
You didn't know I had a dog? How's that possible?
But, well, if he's...
I had no idea you had a dog.
No, I need.
We discussed this in Turks
this whole time.
Nicole won't stop talking.
What's your dog's name again?
Miles.
And what is he? What kind of dog is he?
Cocker Spaniel.
Nah, you said Spaniel.
just a little advice, seeing that I have three dogs. If your dog is farting and he looking like he needs to go outside, he's about to have a dump.
He's ventured off to somewhere, so we'll see.
Oh, yeah, he's having it. Do you have a golf net?
I'm looking to invest in
one. You better check in Nicole's bras. Maybe she better check her bra next time she uses it.
So anyway, we couldn't get any good videos or pictures of them because it was too dark outside. And so I came inside, and Brooksy said, just try one more time. Literally the only 20-second piece of video I had, and it was so good. I don't know if you guys saw. I thought it was so good because they were all standing there looking at me like, "Thanks a lot for dressing us up, you idiots." But then I kind of walked past them and turned around, and they all kind of fell into line.
It looked like
horses on a ranch.
Yeah, I know. It was funny. It was good. Yeah,
so that was a literal one take of my dogs, and they're brilliant actors. So, oh my god, yeah, that was our Halloween activity. Hey, Stoff, it's time for your everybody's favorite segment, things that I saw on Twitter.
I know we're trying to move this along, but I have a little bit of a story about my week that was, if I'd like to share, if you don't mind.
Whoa, very quickly. You've never had anything on the week that was. Oh, that's because I've never let you talk.
So,
Lester, wait a second. Let me do it right. Lester, how was your week?
Thanks for asking, James. It was very good. But I had a little bit of a problem, something that came up that I found was a little bit offside. You know, not a-hole or okay, but offside. So I've been having a reoccurring issue with my water heater / boiler for my furnace / in a hot water heat. So I had a guy from the company, I won't say the name of the company, come over. But, you know, he says, he comes down to the basement, he has a look, and he says, "Okay, it's fine. Do you mind if I use your bathroom for a second?" So there's no problem. So typically they go in, they turn on the hot water, whatever. This guy closes the door, and I'm sitting in the other room, and I am sure this guy has a monumental dump in my bathroom.
Oh, that's offside.
You're like, you can't do that. You can't do it.
Let's do it as an a-hole or a-okay. I say a-hole.
How do you know?
Oh, I heard it. Like, this is... you know what I mean? Oh, this is all...
He didn't turn the fan on? Question.
No! Oh. That's the other thing. Turn the fan on. Motherfucker, turn the fan on. You know what I'm saying? Like, come on!
Like, Paul Jackson all of a sudden came in.
Who is this person supposed to be? A repairman?
Yeah, the guy came to repair my hot water heater. Yeah, and boiler.
Did you check his credentials?
Well, look, he seemed to be
maybe
legit.
He's just a serial s***er.
But you know what I mean? Like, think about it. Yeah. Not only are we talking about that that's inappropriate at the best of times, but it's a pandemic. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Two things. Two questions. Do you keep a little like spray, like a nice scented spray in your bathroom to take care of those things?
I don't. I have a candle though.
Everybody should have that, because if you do get in a situation like that where you have to at a friend's house, it's good to have the spray. Well, Brooksy has some organic friggin' gluten-free something that she sprays around the bathroom. So it always smells wonderful when I walk in there.
Hold on a second. I thought when you went in the washroom, you closed your nostrils. That is what you've led us to believe.
No, I'm talking about I will leave it behind. Like, so oh, if I happen to have one, then I will spray it nicely so it smells nice for the next person.
Oh.
You know, do you know what I'm saying? Oh, I don't close my nostrils when I'm in there like by myself.
Let me just say this. I mean, I'm joking a little bit because obviously the guy, there's no choice. He had to go. Like from what I heard, it was pretty significant, you know, but you know, still maybe excuse yourself. Go to Tim Hortons or something. Drop it there. You know what I mean?
Let me ask you this.
COVID, you can't really go anywhere.
Yeah,
that's true too.
He basically thought you had a clean bathroom. You felt safe.
It was quite clean.
Should take as a compliment.
You know,
some people, do you know some people are much more open than others about talking about things. Do you think that would it have made you feel better or worse if he said to you, hey, do you mind if I use your bathroom? I'm sorry, but I really have to take it down.
No, I don't want to. I'd rather what happened, to be honest with you. If he came out and said, I apologize, I had to go or something like that, maybe I'd have been okay. But I equate this to Gretzky on a breakaway. He hated breakaways because he didn't want to have to think about it. You know, he just wants to get there and shoot the puck. So I'm saying, I don't want to think about you taking a dump in my house. Just take the dump and I'll deal with it after. You know what I mean?
That's fair. Puffy. Yes. We it could have been a situation like Puffy told us about in season one, I believe episode one or two, where he just had no choice and it just came flying out, right? In the middle of downtown Toronto. And in that case, you have to feel for the guy. But let's put ourselves in that position. What would you do? Like, oh, let's say, okay, so we're not furnace repairmen, obviously. So let's say we're at a...
I have played that role on occasion.
Okay. Oh, shoot. So I have... I got an interlude here that I got a note on Instagram. The recycling guy who's outside my house right now, he picks up my recycling. He bought my book. And he asked me if I could sign the book for him.
Don't let him in. He's going to take a dump. He's going to take a shit in your house.
Don't let him in, Jimmy.
Don't let him do it.
No, he's a very nice guy. And so he said he'd come over. So I said, well, when do you want to come over? He said, well, I'll come over while I'm doing the recycling. So,
please welcome the next guest on our podcast.
I actually think he listened to the podcast too.
There you go.
So live appearance. For him. So I have to go out right now. You guys continue the poop discussion. This
will go well.
My things. I'll be right back.
Okay. This is hilarious.
So, you guys like things?
Hey guys, do you like stuff?
Let's listen.
Stuff's good.
Can we hear anything?
What do you think the chances that James has any idea this guy's name?
No chance. Zero chance.
You think he just writes...
He said the recycling guy.
Thanks, bud, and signs it?
It's a lot of bud. Yeah, thanks, bud.
Maybe a brother.
Do you think he'll have more than one copy of the book? Like, do you think he's just got one for himself, or do you think he'll have one for, like, his family, too? Like, friends?
Nah, he's got one copy.
Maybe he's got a whole stack, and he's just going to be selling them after.
Hey, stop. What happened with your dog, man?
Oh, he just went downstairs. He's laying on his little couch. He seems content. Switched up his diet. We have to put water in his food and heat it up for him, so he likes that.
Really?
Fantastic.
Yeah, he's got it made.
Yeah, good. Thank you. Good. You don't have a dog, eh, Puff?
Yeah, I got a dog.
Yeah, you do? What kind of dog do you have?
15-year-old cockapoo.
This is fascinating podcasting.
This is unbelievable. Oh, he's coming back. I think he comes. Here he comes. He's coming.
And that's the story of my life.
Yeah. That was... Was that the best segment you guys have ever done?
Oh, absolutely.
Me and Puffy had a staring contest for 3 minutes. The listeners lost.
So, it's not over.
I was Rob, my recycling guy, who...
Ooh, Rob.
He bought a book for his... I think it was his father-in-law, Gary, who... Rob just told me Gary was a science teacher who used to teach Jeff O'Neill.
No, my school. God. We gotta get Gary on as a guest.
we need to get Gary on. So,
well, if Gary taught anything higher than grade 9, I don't know how much he really talked.
Wow.
Cruel but fair.
Definitely he was on the league. I think he dialed it back on the studies.
I don't think that's so uncommon either.
No, not at all. Not at all. Hey, just the one book?
I end up giving Rob one because, you know what, especially when my kids are home, we go through a lot of recycling. And so I always feel guilty to the recycling guy when I leave like 5 blue bins out there or something like that. And he's super nice. And so I, because he brought a book by, I gave him my own book. Now everybody listening is going to want their own book. So
James, did you know his name before 5 minutes ago?
Yeah, well, he wrote me. I didn't know that beforehand. But I do tip. I do tip. Like at Christmas time, I'll put like a couple of 20s.
What?
I'll tape them onto the recycling box.
That's pretty good.
Are you serious?
I'm going to note that for later.
Exactly.
Well, that's what I always wonder. Because you know how those guys, do you know those guys that run through your neighborhoods in pickup trucks, like going through the garbage looking for stuff?
Yeah.
My guy has a shopping cart with him.
Yeah. Well, there are.
He's better equipped than pickup truck guys.
No, it's a pickup truck that comes all the time looking for stuff, and so I'm like, you better not take my 20s.
I actually do have a funny story about that. So one time, I guess I didn't have my recycling out when the guy who goes through the stuff was out there. So I was putting my recycling out in the morning, and he was already going through my neighbors as if he passed my house. I literally put mine down. I went into my car. And I could see him in the mirror. He walked up, he looked through mine, and he like kind of kicked it as if he was disappointed as to what was in there and that he actually, out of his way, went back to check and there was nothing for him to take.
Oh, my God. That's hilarious.
So, yeah. What? People are so weird.
Yeah.
That is strange. That is Stoff. A strange one. Great producer, lousy garbage content. what the heck were we talking about before I had to run away and help out my recycling guy with an autograph?
Shitting on Lester's house.
Signing books and sending them off takes more time than actually writing the book. That's the one thing. When you do a book that has like 100 interviews and you promise everybody in the book, plus their mother and their sister and their brother books. Because when you're doing the book, you're like, anything to get a story, right? Hey, do you think you can send me a few? Oh, yeah, no problem. And then the...
Of course.
Comes around, right? And then Jimmy's got to pay the price. And
of course.
Yeah. There's a lot of mail going out of this house right now. Where the hell were we? We were talking about pooping in the house. Oh, I wanted to know. Okay. So I wouldn't say with us, like if any of you guys came to my house and you had to do your stuff, no problem. We're good enough friends, right?
Yeah.
But what if it was, okay, let's think of an acquaintance. So let's say, one of our bosses, Ken Volden, has a little dinner party and invites us all over. And you have to go really bad, like this guy, clearly Lester. Do you? You probably do, don't you?
Yeah, 100%, for sure.
Yeah, you just make sure that everything, you don't show that you're doing it. You turn the tap on, you make sure, you know.
Yeah, you want to make it sound like you're taking a bath in there.
I would just tell people that I was masturbating. A lot easier, a lot less tough.
To me, it all depends. Like if I'm violently ill, I'm leaving the party. I can't do that to somebody else.
Of course. Yeah, you know? I'm with you.
One of my buddies told me a story once. He was dating this girl, and her family invited him over for dinner. And in the middle of dinner, he had to go use the washroom, which was pretty much right next to where they were eating, and there was no fan in the washroom.
Oh, that's horrific. So
basically, they heard everything. So yeah, that relationship did not last.
Yeah,
never mind the hearing. What about the smell? That's what I want to know. You having a nice filet mignon, and
Hey, Puffy, should I text Nicole or Kenny and say we're going to be a few minutes late? Will they accept us being a few minutes late on this Masters call? I think so, right? They respect the pod. I'm just going to send a quick note.
You know who you are. They can't have the meeting without you, Jim. Jimmy?
Drop Lester's name. Get it done.
Might be 5 minutes late on call. I'll say, just talk to the cameraman about their carnets for 5 minutes. that's an inside Puffy and I joke, isn't it, Puff?
Well, I certainly don't get it. You know what I mean?
I don't even know what a carnet is.
Well, when you take a lot of equipment over the border, you need a piece of paper called a carnet that they has to get signed, and all the cameramen obsess, particularly Dean Willers and Mark Millett, two of our favorites, obsess about the carnets. Like if you have a noon flight, they want to be there at 6 a.m. in case the carnets take a while. So it's
The carnets are always quick.
Carnets are like 10 minutes. So ask every TSN reporter, Sarah Orleski, 1999, Mark Masters, Farhan Lalji, Ryan Rashad, any of the anchors that travel a lot. The bane of their existence is cameramen obsessed with carnets. Yeah. But I guess it's the 1 in 20 time that there's a 2-hour lineup for the carnets.
Yeah.
That makes them go 4 hours to the airport. Anyway. Let's get to things that I saw on Twitter.
Freaky pigs, strange chicks, world affairs, polar bears, fake news, nice shoes, big boobs, jack dudes, all of these things and more as I sat on the shitter. Things that I saw on Twitter.
This is the Christoph Mamona special. Go ahead, Christoph.
All right. So the first one I came across was a story about a man stealing a bulldozer to dig up a bunch of Biden-Harris signs. So obviously there's a political angle to it, but that's not the part I want to get into. My question is, what possesses someone to steal a bulldozer? And in the article, it does have a quote from the guy, and it says, "I've been drinking whiskey all day and don't remember what happened." Fair or foul?
That's fair. That's fair.
That's it. That's,
yeah, see?
That's a defense. That is a defense.
That's not a defense for everything Puffy's done in his life.
just throw it right out the window.
Well, that would, I mean, you would probably get, what would you get for stealing a bulldozer? Would you serve time for that?
Not if Donald Trump
wins. No, that's very true, too, Jesus. If you're backing that guy.
Secretary of Defense.
Wow.
A patriot. A true patriot. Stole the bulldozer. Okay, what else, Duff?
Well, we'll stay on Trump for 1 second here. You know, he had one of his last rallies yesterday. And are you guys familiar with recording artist Little Pump?
I saw this.
Well, I mean, Donald is definitely familiar, as he is with anyone who supports him. Let's take a listen to the shout out.
And speaking of sound, music, and other things, one of the big superstars of the world, Little Pimp.
He goes on to ask the crowd, you guys know who he is, and you know, all those supporters who've never heard of him just cheer loudest as possible, but
we're all paid to be there.
You know, the underrated comedy in Trump, though, is just, he tried to do a segue there and he said, speaking of music, crowds, and everything else in the world. Here's Little Pimp.
You know, Saturday Night Live, they've done a little bit. They have a little bit about if Trump loses, what are people going to talk about? You know what I mean? So they have this whole thing where they're, you know. Anyway, continue, Stoff. Sorry.
No worries. Thank you for that introduction.
I have to say, I hope you do it again, because my favorite part of the last episode was when I told Stoff to put the crickets in after one of your jokes fell flat, and he just extended it for like about 15 seconds and played The Sound of Silence by Simon and Garfunkel. And it was, so I hope you do an encore performance of that after that little story.
For sure. Consider it done.
Anything else there, Stoff?
Since, you know, on this podcast, we love sea creatures, octopus or octopi and such. Yeah. You know, I bring you this story of a giant whale's tail that saved an entire metro train from derailing in Holland.
Nice.
Now, it wasn't an actual whale. It was the statue of a whale. And we'll tweet the photo out. And you literally see the train goes off the tracks, but doesn't go flying off because it is supported by the giant tail of a whale statue.
Right.
The octopus would not have done that. It would have went right through.
Are you kidding? My pet octopus would have done that in a heartbeat. Octopuses are amazing. You know what? We could do the. I'll just interrupt you. Since we're on things I saw on Twitter, I have to. You guys don't see him anymore, right? You guys see me still?
No, we don't. Why? What are you going to do?
Well, I have to go on the Twitter to do this, and I don't know how to be actually seen on Skype and doing this. But the William McAvoy or the Liam McAvoy tweet of the week.
Is that the one calling us out about the cloacas?
Oh, yes, that one. I was going to read Andrew Arsenault because he was trying to do a nice version of the Liam McAvoy tweet of the week. He just said, be kind to each other. You never know when someone's having a bad day. A simple hi, how are you? Just might be enough to make someone's day. Huh? So kind of sweet, kind of a hallmark version that Andrew wanted to get on. But go ahead. What were you going to say? Oh, the cloaca thing.
Yeah. Well, apparently it's not cloaca at all.
Yeah.
So our listener tweets in, I've loved the pod, all of them from day one. I've patiently waited for someone else to say something. I didn't want to be that guy, but I can't stand it no longer. The word cloaca has three syllables. Cloaca.
Cloaca.
The pronunciation is cloaca.
Cloaca.
Okay, but he sent a link that took us to like a YouTube pronunciation guide. You can play that.
Cloaca.
Coca-la-coy.
Yes, and that's my question. Is it just another fraudulent one it's Juan not, Wario?
It's not, because I went through several of them. Like, I literally went on YouTube, typed in cloaca, and the pronunciation, and they're all cloaca. So, and it actually doesn't just refer to the bird part. I think it's something like an opening that works both ways. That's what an actual cloaca is. I think it's a plumbing term as well.
Oh.
But apparently that is how you pronounce it, and we were wrong.
Cloaca. Well, can we go back and redo all those episodes?
Yeah, I'm going to actually edit. If we all say cloaca once, I will go back and I will edit all those in.
Cloaca.
I have absolutely nothing better to do.
Cloaca.
Cloaca.
Juan Wario.
Juan Wario.
Is the teeth of Juan Wario.
Juan Wario.
Cloaca.
Cloaca.
All right. Is there anything else on things that I saw on Twitter?
Kanye's gift.
Yeah, we do. Do you want to discuss Kanye? We also have the Cowboys defensive coordinator who put hot sauce in his eye right before.
Yeah, I doing saw the that. Presser. That was ridiculous. What was Kanye? Go ahead.
Kanye was for Kim's 40th birthday. He gave her a hologram, I guess, of her late father speaking to her. We'll play a bit of that here.
Happy birthday, Kimberly. Look at you. You're 40 and all grown up. You look beautiful, just like when you were a little girl. You married the most genius man in the whole world, Kanye West.
I mean, it's a nice gesture, although still a little creepy just from the onset.
Oh, yeah.
But the couple things he says in there, especially saying that you married the most brilliant man on earth or the biggest genius.
It was awesome.
Like, at that point, how does that gift mean anything to Kim? Like, it's actually disgusting.
It's weird. Like, I don't know. I don't know. Would you want to see... Puffy's lost a parent. I've lost a parent at this point in time. Would you want to have a hologram?
Would you want Kanye West to write the script for what they're going to say to you?
That's... No, I would not want to.
Definitely not.
Kanye West involved.
You married the best rapper there is. Those other rappers. I'm so much better than Drake. Oh, also, go Trump.
Oh, well, no, Kanye's running on his own, so.
The cloaca came from David Aaron DeMann. David Aaron DeMann. I like to give our people some love. Also, Stefan said that Lester was on fire this episode with his condoms comment. So you got a lot of praise for your performance last week. Stefan also said, when you guys started doing the Green Needle versus Brainstorm chat, it was bringing old people Facebook straight into a podcast. I enjoyed that. And one last one from Jeff Krause, following up on the lottery episode, says that I can request from retailers an unclaimed prize report from a retailer that will tell you how many max prizes are left in each scratch ticket. So I can help decide which of my $20 scratch lottery tickets.
Okay.
Like,
okay.
So there you go. Information you can use. Puffy and I have to go talk about the Masters. When we hear from you next week, we will be at the Masters if all goes well, unless there's a civil war. And by the way, Puffy, I made it known to Sean Redmond, Stu Johnson, Ken Volden, our bosses, that if there is civil war in Georgia because of the election results and our bus gets hijacked or something, that you and Bump do have to sacrifice yourselves for me and Weeksy's of talent.
The sad part is they've also made that clear to us.
Yes. Actually, Sean Redmond's text to me was, that's literally his job description. America, I hope you're okay right now. And everything's all right by the time people listen to this. And we'll see you next week from the Augusta National on the Rubber Boots Podcast.
I can't stand it when I'm on a Zoom call and somebody's got their audio cranked. Drives me nuts.
I can't stand if I'm on a Zoom call and they're cranking something else.
Hey, how are you? I got a question that I really want to ask you. Wait, don't hang up. I need to know, so I'm gonna try and push my luck. Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? Are they purple, yellow, green, or black or white? Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? Do you like the dunk tank at the fair? Oh, I know it's a little strange. My obsession with your choice of footwear in the rain. And I know that you're on TV, but I need you to put your boots up on the desk for me. Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? Are they purple, yellow, green, or black or white? Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? Do you like the dunk tank at the fair? Do you really like the dunk tank at the fair?
Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight?